Allahu Allahu Allah Allah.
Par excellence presents Jewels from the Holy Quran, a series of lectures by Mufti Ismail ibn Musa Menk.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. الحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise is due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى, Lord of the worlds. والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Complete blessings and salutations be upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and all his companions. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى bless us all. Honored ulama, beloved brothers, dearest sisters and listeners, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us in that we have completed half of the Quran today. We have listened to half of this Quran in Salat al-Taraweeh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala write us from amongst those who have definitely stood in Salat al-Taraweeh for His sake, and who have fasted for His sake, for definitely. In the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, those who stand for the sake of Allah expecting a reward, and those who fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expecting a reward, their reward will be none besides Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. In the verses that were read tonight, we firstly completed Surah An-Nahl, the surah that we spoke about last night, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention a lot of His gifts that He has granted us. And from amongst these gifts, He speaks of the bee, and He speaks of the honey coming from the bee, and He says there is cure and shifa in that honey. And for this reason, it is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to have a bit of honey. We too should understand that we must give preference to honey over the ordinary sugar that we have in our cupboards. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the acceptance to do that. It has shifa, and it is part of the sunnah and practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shifa meaning cure. Cure from all sickness, cure from even some spiritual maladies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure us from all types of sickness. Also in the verses we read tonight, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Quran in one of the surahs that we read tonight.
وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ.
Even in the Quran, that which we have revealed in it that wherein there is shifa and cure for those who believe, and there is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you find a person who reads the Quran, a person who endeavors to understand the Quran, a person who even listens to the recitation of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant that person lots of mercy. The person will feel very, very soothed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calm our hearts and minds. Ameen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in the opening verses that we read tonight. He speaks of the commands in a nutshell that Islam holds, and the prohibitions in a nutshell that Islam has prohibited.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ.
Allah instructs us to uplift and uphold justice at all times, to be just and fair at every single time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks us to be good at all times. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also asks us to reach out to those who are close to us, those who are in need. When we say reach out, it does not only mean to give them wealth. Any form of goodness from us to other people is included in this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us good. May Allah make us torchbearers of this deen, so that wherever we walk, people can look at us as Muslimin and realize that the true picture of a Muslim is he who is helpful to entire humanity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits evil, immorality, and he prohibits oppression, any form of oppression and transgression is prohibited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All forms of immorality are prohibited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the acceptance to understand this particular verse and put it into our lives. For indeed, if we put into practice just this one verse, inshallah, we will be putting into practice the entire deen. Alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. And obviously, when we say this, what is included in the details of this particular verse, the whole deen is included. As we mentioned a few moments ago about, meaning a few days ago, about the person who guarantees the correct use of the tongue and the correct use of the private parts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guarantee that person Jannah. In fact, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I stand as the guarantee. مَنْ يَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمَنْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever can guarantee me the correct use of these two organs, I will guarantee him or her Jannah. In a nutshell, that means whoever lives their entire lives according to the decree and command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall be guaranteed Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. Then regarding spending, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is drawing our attention to something. Firstly, sustenance comes from Allah. We all know that. Rabbul Izzati wa Jalal. He is in control of entire sustenance. But if we become stingy and we just want to amass the wealth, Allah tells us, whatever you've left in this world, when you die, it is going to go to someone else. It's not yours. Somebody else's name will be written next to it as soon as you die. But whatever you've spent in the right cause whilst you were alive, your name was written next to that. مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. That which you keep with you is going to be depleted. And that which you've deposited with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall remain. And that is what is going to benefit you and help you in the akhirah. This is one of the interpretations of this verse. So it's important that we spend in the path of Allah as much as we can. We spend even on our own family members, whatever we can. In fact, in Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how to spend. And he tells us, وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبَذِيرًا. Don't be extravagant. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Those who are extravagant are the brethren of Shaytan. وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِرَبِّهِ كَفُورًا. And Shaytan is very, very ungrateful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who are extravagant. So how should we spend? Allah explains that a few verses later. And he says, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطُهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْسُورًا. You should not be so stingy, nor should you be so generous that you give away your own basic necessities. You should strike a balance between the two. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to strike a balance between being stingy and being over generous to the degree that we give preference to others over those who are under our own guardianship. Now, one might ask, what is the meaning of extravagance in the Sharia? It means to have two of what you need one of. But it does not mean that if I buy a very expensive item, then I am extravagant. No, if I can afford it, alhamdulillah. The hadith says, لِيَظْهَرْ أَثَرَ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ. When Allah has granted you wealth, He would like it to be seen on you, in your clothing and in other items that you have. Not out of pride, but out of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are making use of what He has given you. Alhamdulillah. So to buy quality is not extravagance. But to buy quantity when it is not needed is extravagance. If you open your cupboard when you go home and you find 50 pairs of clothes, that's a waste. That's extravagance. Even if those clothes are very, very cheap, and even if they are tatty and torn, it's extravagance. You have something which you don't need at all. But if you have a number of pairs of clothing which you need and you know you wear and you make use of, even if they happen to be very expensive, for as long as you can afford it, alhamdulillah. I have not stolen, I have not begged or borrowed or stolen. Alhamdulillah, it is good. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us complete understanding of this. Sometimes people see a person with a very expensive motor vehicle and they say, look, that man is extravagant. Not necessarily. Even if you have little Mini Coopers, but you have 10 of them sitting, it's a waste of time. It's a waste of money. You are not going to use them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us not from amongst those who are extravagant. Rather, we reach out to the poor and needy, and we spend money on those we are meant to be spending on, because by doing that, we will be depositing money in the bank of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. In the akhirah, we will find Jannah as a result. One hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, مَنْ بَنَى لِلَّهِ مَسْجِدًا بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Whosoever builds a house, a masjid, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build for that person a house in Jannah. That means they've now deposited their wealth in the right direction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause that wealth to be multiplied. May Allah multiply our wealth for us, and may He make us generous in the month of Ramadan within the limits of this sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about how every person shall come on the day of Qiyamah, defending himself or herself.
يَوْمَ تَأْتِي كُلُّ نَفْسٍ تُجَادِلُ عَن نَفْسِهَا.
On that day, every soul shall come in front of رَبُّ الْعِزَّةِ وَالْجَلَالِ, and each soul will be defending himself or herself. Everyone will try and justify what deeds they have done. Now, in another verse, also from amongst the verses we read tonight, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes what the criminals shall say. Who are the criminals? The criminals are those who did not engage in tawbah before they died. They didn't engage in tawbah. And they were arrogant until the point of death. They died and then they reached Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sins that they had not repented regarding. May Allah grant us all repentance. We don't want to be criminals. This is why Allah gives us opportunity after opportunity, and He reminds us so many times to say, turn, it's not too late. Every heartbeat speaks to us, if only we can hear what the heartbeat is saying. Do you think this heartbeat is going to carry on forever? When you put your hand on your heart and you can hear it pumping, it's going to stop one day. It's a weak little organ which stops a few years down the line. It is telling us, turn to Allah. I am going to stop one day. But we don't hear that because we are weak. We need to turn to Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. So the mujrimeen, what will they say on the day of Qiyamah? They will say, regarding the books,
مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا.
What is it with this book? This book that is here in front of us with all our deeds, it has not left a small thing or a big thing. Everything is recorded in this book. Allahu Akbar. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say,
اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا.
Everybody will be told, read your own book. This book that is spread in front of you, read it, for it is sufficient as evidence against you. Your own book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from amongst those whose books shall bear witness against them. There is a way of deleting what is in that book, but only now whilst we are alive.
التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له.
The one who seeks forgiveness from a sin is equivalent to the one who's never ever committed a sin in the past. Subhanallah. Look at the mercy of Allah. The one who seeks forgiveness from a sin will be equivalent to the one who's never ever committed a sin. Allahu Akbar. More than that, the Quran says,
إِلَّا مَن تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ.
Those who believe and do good deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, upon their repentance, will convert their bad deeds into good deeds. So when they come on the day of Qiyamah, they will see lots and lots of good deeds, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, didn't I promise you I would do this for you? May Allah make us from amongst those. We've all done bad deeds. We need the hope in the mercy of Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. These are the blessed nights of Ramadan, which are full of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيْلٌ لِّمَنْ أَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانَ فَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. Destruction be upon the one who has witnessed the month of Ramadan and has exited that month without having been forgiven. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Wallahi, it's a month of softening of the hearts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the books will be placed before us and how all our deeds shall be recorded. As I said, if you'd like to delete those books and we'd like to format the hard drives that we have, it's very simple. All we need to do, engage in sincere tawbah and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those who do bad deeds and then they turn to Allah. How will Allah treat them? At the end of Surah An-Nahl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
ثُمَّ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لِلَّذِينَ عَمِلُوا السُّوءَ بِجَهَالَةٍ ثُمَّ تَابُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ وَأَصْلَحُوا إِنَّ رَبَّكَ مِنْ بَعْدِهَا لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ.
The treatment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards those who have repented and thereafter do good deeds and mend their ways is forgiveness, for definitely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most forgiving, most merciful. There we are. That is a verse of the Quran. The verses are full of mercy. And notice, the verses of mercy are repeating themselves on a daily basis. Have we ever come here any day and not heard a verse of mercy? Doesn't this show us that Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal wants to forgive us? But we need to turn to Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how to call the non-Muslims towards Islam. How do we call them towards Islam?
Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'idhati al hasanati wa jadilhum billati hiya ahsan.
When you call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, call with wisdom and tact. Call with lots of wisdom and tact. Don't attack people and don't invite people negatively. Don't call people towards goodness in a negative manner. Call them in a positive manner so that they can look forward to it rather than feeling doomed. Call people with wisdom, bil hikmah, and call them with good speech, a good reminder.
Al maw'idhati al hasanah.
That reminder which is good, a good reminder, not a bad reminder, not a negative reminder. And when you tackle them,
wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan.
When you tackle them with that which is the best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the acceptance, not only to deal with the non-Muslims in this way, but even with the Muslims. Sometimes we are guilty of dooming people, labeling people, kicking people out of the fold of Islam. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set aside a whole day to do that. Yawmul Qiyamah is a huge day where Maliki Yawmiddin, the owner of Day of Judgment, has set it aside for him to judge. And we begin to become judgmental here in the dunya, labeling this one and that one, hating this one and that one, calling this one outside the fold and this one inside the fold. That is a very, very dangerous trend that people are following. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite this ummah and may He allow us to feel the brotherhood. Yes, we will have differences, but for as long as we are within the framework of Islam, we must learn to tolerate one another. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. Thereafter, in the next surah, which is Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commences by making mention of that journey by night of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wherein he was taken from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Makkah Al-Mukarramah, right up to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, and from there he was taken up to the heavens in body and person and soul. He was taken up himself physically. May Allah grant us the understanding. Now Allah makes mention of it.
Subhana الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير.
Allah speaks about the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who took his slave on a journey by night from Al-Masjid Al-Haram to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. That is known as Al-Isra. That journey on land was known as Al-Isra. From Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa going up to the heavens, that was known as Al-Mi'raj. And for this reason, we refer to it as Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. There are many lessons from Mi'raj. Let me draw one lesson. From the timing of the Mi'raj, it happened after what was known as Amul Huzn, the year of grief and sadness. That year, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost his wife Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala anha. And he lost his uncle. And he went to Ta'if. And in Ta'if he was beaten. And we've heard about how the children even threw stones at him in Ta'if. And he did not complain. He did not complain about them. He made a dua for them to say, Ya Allah, guide them. They don't know. O Allah, guide my people. They don't know what they are doing. The malaika told him, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are prepared to destroy and crush this group of people between the mountains. Just give us a command. He raised his hands. And he says, Allahumma inni ashku ilayka. Oh Allah, I'm complaining to you. Imagine the best of creation raised his hands to complain. What was that complaint? The angels, everyone listening. What is the complaint? What does he want to say? If he commands us to destroy them, now we will destroy them. How can the best of creation complain about someone and we don't deal with those? He was already told, tell us and we will destroy them by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when the complaint came out, do you know what he says? Listen to the example. Allahumma inni ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, I'm complaining about my weakness, my own weakness. I am weak. I'm not complaining about these people. Ya Allah, you have placed on my shoulders to deliver the message. Ya Allah, I haven't been able to deliver the message to these people. They haven't listened to me. Allahu Akbar. Oh Allah, guide them. They don't know what they are doing. Obviously, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fulfilled the message. He delivered it. But because he wanted them to be guided, and he really wanted that, that is why he was saddened when they threw stones. Rather than cursing them and destroying them, he made a dua, Ya Allah, if you're not going to guide them, guide their progeny. Go to Ta'if today. Today. There is not a single citizen of Ta'if who is not a Muslim. The dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So, for that reason, my dear listeners, let's listen to something. When making a dua, rather than just making a dua for destruction of anyone and everyone, first try the dua, Ya Allah, guide them. First try the dua, Ya Allah, guide them to Islam. Take a look at Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a dua, Allahumma a'izz al-Islam bi ahad al-Umarain. Oh Allah, grant strength to this Islam through the acceptance of Islam of either Amr ibn Hisham, who was Abu Jahl, or Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. No sooner was that dua made than this man coming to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declaring, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka abduhu wa rasuluh. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu accepted Islam. So sometimes we need to make dua, Ya Allah, guide the enemy to Islam. Ya Allah, soften their hearts to Islam. And if you have not written guidance for them, then Ya Allah, deal with them in a manner that you feel fit. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us from the evil plot of those who would like to plot evil against the Muslims. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I was saying, the timing of this mi'raj, Allah gave it as a gift. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very patient. He was very patient. Allah gave him a gift, took him up to mi'raj. We learn from it something indirectly. And that is, any one of us who is patient for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, somehow, somewhere, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us a gift. He will open the doors of His mercy for us in the dunya, or in the akhirah, or in both of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness in both. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after that speaks about being good to one's parents. And these verses come within verses that are known as al-hikmah, the wisdom. Didn't we speak about wisdom moments ago? Now listen to the wisdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and there are many verses all in a sequence. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah says, He declares that you shall worship none besides Him. Don't associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you shall be good to your parents. Why do the two come together? It's very easy to understand. Allah created us, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. And He chose two people in order to bring us through them to this world. So Allah created us through some means. That means is a sacred means. And we need to respect the womb that gave birth to us. We need to respect our parents. This is the reason. And that's why the Quran also speaks about those whose parents might not be Muslims. We are still meant to be very good to them and obey them in that which does not come out of the framework of the Sharia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us obedient children. And Allah says, when they are old, make dua for them.
Make dua for them. وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا.
Oh Allah, have mercy on them, because they looked after me when I was young. Had they left me alone when I was a little toddler, a little baby, an infant, I might have even died. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also speaks about giving those who are related to us. Remember, when we give to the poor, the first circle is that of those who are closer to us. Look at them, see. If there are poor people from amongst them, reach out to them. And I prefer to use the word reach out, because sometimes they don't only want wealth. They want you to visit them, to talk to them, a good word to solve the family problems and so on. That is also goodness. Reaching out to your family members. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the acceptance. Then, within the verses, there are two very interesting prohibitions. Very interesting. Why? Normally Allah tells us don't do this and don't do that. But there are certain sins where Allah says don't even come close to those. Don't even approach them. Not even from a distance. What are those?
وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً.
The first one, I'm sure we've all understood it. Don't even approach zina. Why don't approach? The eyes can be used as spears of shaitan. You know, when you are going out hunting and you've seen a buck and you've seen it running in front of you, good looking buck, and you know you've got the spear set and ready, and you release the spear, you hit the buck, you run behind the buck until you get it and slaughter it. So the hadith uses a similar example where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, watch your eyes. They are the spears sometimes of shaitan. If you do not lower your gaze, you might look at something and then your mind will not be at ease until you get the kal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And zina is described in the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm sure we've heard about it. Allah says, don't even get close. May Allah forgive everyone, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us, keep us strong, and protect us all. So that is the first sin. Allah says, don't even come close. What about the other one where Allah says, don't come close?
وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ.
Don't even come close to the wealth of an orphan. When someone has died and there is an estate, don't think of stealing even 1 cent. Yes, the orphan child is used. When we read this verse in Surah, or a similar verse in Surah An-Nisa, I remember mentioning that the orphan here is used because he or she is vulnerable. More so the female child. Many people complain about how some who are, meaning if you look at them, they appear to be so religious. They might read 5 salah in the masjid with jama'ah. But when it comes to the laws of inheritance, they begin to steal from their sisters and their mothers and their daughters. And they tell them, you know what, you were already given in the lifetime of the deceased, so now you have no share. Or they undervalue the property because they don't want to give the ladies. We've spoken about this so many times because Allah has repeated in the Quran so many times. Here it is. Allah says, don't even come close to thinking about stealing from those who are vulnerable when someone close to them has died. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about how we should utter only that which is correct and good.
وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ.
Don't even utter that which you don't have knowledge about. If you don't know something, say, I don't know. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us and informing us,
إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا.
Allah is going to ask us about our sight, about our ears, about our hearts, about our thoughts. Allah will ask us. He's going to question us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all forgiveness, and may He make us use these faculties in a manner that they will bear witness for us and not against us. We know in the Quran, in Surah Yasin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us,
الْيَوْمَ نَخْتِمُ عَلَىٰ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتُكَلِّمُنَا أَيْدِيهِمْ وَتَشْهَدُ أَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ.
On the day of Qiyamah, Allah will seal our mouths, or seal the mouths of the people, and their hands will speak out, their legs will speak out as to what they used to earn. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let our hands and legs speak for us and not against us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about how people questioned resurrection. Do you know what they said?
وَقَالُوا.
The kuffar of Quraysh at that time, these were the utterances that they uttered.
أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا وَرُفَاتًا أَإِنَّا لَمَبْعُوثُونَ خَلْقًا جَدِيدًا.
When we become bone and when we are dispersed and when we have decomposed into the soil, are we going to be resurrected anew? Are we going to be resurrected once again? The response comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قُلْ كُونُوا حِجَارَةً أَوْ حَدِيدًا.
When you decompose, become what you want. When you are decomposed, you can become rock or you can become steel or iron. Allah says,
أَوْ خَلْقًا مِمَّا يَكْبُرُ فِي صُدُورِكُمْ.
Or you can become any creature that might be considered as large and big in your own hearts. The Mufassirin have explained that. What is meant by that? It means you can become death itself. You can become death. That is something that requires a lot of pondering to understand. If a person becomes death, can he die? He can't die because he is death. So Allah says, you can become death. And Allah says,
فَسَيَقُولُونَ مَنْ يُعِيدُنَا قُلِ الَّذِي فَطَرَكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ.
Who is going to bring you back to life? They will say, who is going to bring us back to life? Tell them the one who gave that life in the first place. Do you know that after the judgment is complete, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring in the presence of everybody death in the form of a little animal, and Allah will slaughter it. And Allah will say, that was death, we slaughtered it. Now the people of Jannah, there is no death for you. The people of Jahannam, there is no death for you. So death will come in the form of an animal. That means death is a creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah says,
أَوْ خَلْقًا مِمَّا يَكْبُرُ فِي صُدُورِكُمْ.
What do you think you will decompose into? Become anything you want. Become death itself. That doesn't change the qudra and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will definitely resurrect everyone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us in the condition that He is pleased with us. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the same surah about how this Quran, even if everyone tried to come together in order to bring a Quran similar to this and they all helped each other, they would not be able to bring a Quran like this.
قُلْ لَئِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَن يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا.
Even if all humankind and all jinn kind got together and assisted one another in order to try and come with a book similar to the Quran, they will never ever be able to come even close to it. May Allah grant us the power or the acceptance to understand that this Quran is a gift. It has been granted to myself and yourselves. It is the only book that can be memorized the way we have memorized it. Alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from every single one of us, for definitely all of us have memorized even a portion of the Quran. As I said the other day, even Surah Al-Fatiha, mashallah, we all know it. It's part of the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us and resurrect us from amongst those who have memorized even a portion of the Quran. The next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about something very interesting, and the surah is named after that incident. It is known as Surah Al-Kahf. It has a lot of blessings, and I'm sure a lot of us read it on many occasions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding of the lessons within the surah. I'm going to go through a few lessons only. The first is that where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the people, the youngsters, the youth who did not like their environment. And they did not like the ruler who was unjust. They were unable to live their life according to what Allah wanted. So they went to the cave. There are two narrations. One says they all went together to the cave, and the other says that one went, the other one went, and they went separately, but they all arrived at the same cave. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that they made a dua. What was that dua? They made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, Ya Allah, grant us goodness, grant us mercy, protect us from the evil that is going on around us, and help us make decisions in our affairs in a manner that is correct and good.
وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا
رَشَدًا. They asked Allah to protect them and to grant them goodness in their affairs. So what did Allah do as a result? Automatically, immediately, Allah says,
فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا.
For many years, we blocked their ears. Some of the Mufassirin say that If a person does not know what is going on around that person in terms of evil, and they are not interested in learning that which is evil, they may be protected from it because they don't know it. And in the same way, or the opposite is also correct, that when a person starts listening to evil, and when a person listens how easy it is to commit sin, because sin is being committed by everyone in such an easy manner, shaitan might come to that mind to say, you know what, it's so simple to commit sin, why don't you commit sin? But when we don't know about it, we may never even think about it. I know a few days ago, I made mention of how we should know what is evil so that we can stay away from it. But sometimes there is evil that we don't know about, we will never know about unless we go to places of evil. That becomes haram. No one can go to the nightclub and tell me, no, you know what, we went to the nightclub because we were told to come and see what the evil is all about. That is foolish. Nobody can go to a place where only haram happens, to a bar, and sit there with all the drunkards and then say, I went to the bar only to see what was going on. Allahu Akbar. May Allah safeguard us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a gift to these youngsters, sealed their ears for a long, long time. They didn't listen to any evil. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how 300 years later, 300 years later they got up, and the Quran mentions the number. وَلَبِثُوا فِي كَهْفِهِمْ 300 سِنِينَ وَازْدَادُوا 9. The Quran says they stayed in the cave, they slept in the cave for 300 years, and they were increased by 9. Now one might ask, what is this increase of 9? In the Old Testament, the story is mentioned, and it is 300 years are spoken about. And in the Quran says 300 and an excess of 9. If you take a look at the difference between the solar years and the lunar years, in 300 solar years, you get exactly 309 lunar years. So that is the increase. Someone might read the Bible and find that, you know what, it says here 300 years, and the Quran says 309 years. There is no contradiction there. Here we are speaking of solar years, and if you multiply it, almost every 35 years, you get about a year. So 350 years, you would get 10 years. 300 years, you get 9 years. Allahu Akbar. So 309 years. That is another miracle of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Another miracle of the Quran. Let me explain you yet another one. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala that وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ كَهْفِهِمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَإِذَا غَرَبَتْ تَقْرِضُهُمْ ذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ وَهُمْ فِي فَجْوَةٍ مِّنْ. If you looked at the sun, you would see when it got up, when it rose on one side of them, and when it set on the other side, and they were in the center of the cave, the sun did not get to them. Do you know that when they got up so many years later, they had not aged at all, because the cave was cool and the sunlight did not even touch them. It is now proven that aging is caused by the sun. Allahu Akbar. Those who work indoors, they will look much younger even when they are 40, 50. And those who work in the sun, they will look very old even when they are 25, 30. It's a fact. So the Quran is telling us how these people were protected because they stayed away from the sunlight. Now I'm not saying we must all walk around with umbrellas, but alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the lesson from this, that really this is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, something else, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاظًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ. When they slept with their eyes opened. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you looked at them, you would have run away because it was so scary. From this, some of the ulama say, when a person dies, rather than leaving their eyes open, if their eyes are open, one of their rights over us who are around them alive is to say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and close the eyes, so that no one is scared of the person. Imagine someone's passed away and they're busy looking at you, meaning the eyes are focused on you. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us safety and security on the day of Qiyamah. We get frightened of a dead person. What about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is alive and who is always watching us? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to fear Him rather than to fear the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are so many other verses that we read tonight, but as you know, the idea of this little synopsis is just to go through a few verses to show us how beautiful this Quran is. the jewels that we extract from this Quran, and every single verse, every letter is a jewel. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a life that we can look into the Quran, understand it, put it into practice, and teach it to others. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.